Good morning. I'd like to call the meeting to order. We will start by introducing everybody. I'll start with Mr. Ramey.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Gary Ramey, Member Lunenburg West.
Good morning. Matt Wynott, MLA Hammonds Plains, Upper Sackville.
Brian Skobar, Member for Cumberland North.
Good morning. Clary McKinnon, MLA Pictou East.
Hi, I'm Morris Smith from Antigonish.
Andrew Younger, Dartmouth East.
Chuck Porter, MLA for Hans West.
Terry Spicer, Assistant Auditor General.
Darlene Henry, Committee Clerk.
Rhea Perkins, Service Nova Scotia Municipal Relations.
Catherine Smith, Service Nova Scotia Municipal Relations.
Kevin Malloy.
Cameron McNeil, Service Nova Scotia Municipal Relations.
Marianne Hacker-Labelle, Director of Finance, Service Nova Scotia Municipal Relations.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome our guests this morning and to our meeting. I will start the proceedings by asking Mr. Malloy if he would like to make a presentation.
Good morning and thank you. Before I proceed, I would just like to reintroduce my team with their title so that we can have a better understanding of what they do in their day job. Cameron McNeil is the Executive Director of Program Management and Corporate Services. Catherine Smith is the Director of Consumer and Business Programs. Marianne Hacker-Labelle is Director of Finance. And Rhea Perkins is a Research and Statistical Officer. I'd like to thank the members of this committee for giving us an opportunity to make some opening comments. Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations is as a diverse government department as you will find. We cover everything from marriages, births, liquor licensing, and geographic information systems to consumer rebates like the Heating Assistance Rebate Program. As we all know, higher fuel prices are a worldwide concern. This province is no exception. Through initiatives like the Heating Assistance Rebate, we're helping lower-income Nova Scotians who are struggling to make ends meet heat their homes. The Heating Assistance Rebate Program was first launched in October of 2008. The program was and continues to be application-based. Single persons with incomes of less than $27,000 and families with incomes of less than $42,000, as well as Nova Scotians receiving income assistance or guaranteed income supplement, were eligible to apply. All must have paid some form of heating bill to qualify for the rebate. The program was changed somewhat for the 2009-10 winter season. The budget for the program was set at $15 million, and the rebate was set at a maximum of $200 for all forms of home heating to help as many Nova Scotians as possible. Income thresholds remained the same. In 2010-2011, the budget for the program was set at $14.9 million. Rebate amounts and income thresholds remain the same, and the province issued about 50,000 rebates. For the 2011-2012 season, the budget remained at $14.9 million, and to date, we have issued more than 51,000 rebates. Now, I would like to talk a little about how we're getting the word out about this program and making sure Nova Scotians who need this assistance can access it. One of the most significant ways we're reaching Nova Scotians is by sending those who received a rebate for a previous year's program, like Keep the Heat, a pre-populated application form to make it easier for them to apply for assistance. For the 2011-2012 season, we sent out about 50,000 pre-populated applications to Nova Scotians who had received the rebate in the previous year. For the In addition, we also make applications for the Heating Assistance Rebate Program available online, at Access Nova Scotia centres, at Department of Community Services offices, at all MLA offices, and at more than 100 community groups, resource centres, and other locations throughout the province, including Feed Nova Scotia, Parker Street Food and Furniture Bank, Family Resource Centres, various seniors organizations, and farmers markets. We also work closely with the Department of Community Services to put inserts in clients' income assistance checks to help them learn about and access the Heating Assistance Rebate Program. Income assistance caseworkers also receive applications to give to their clients. Efficiency Nova Scotia receives copies of the application and also works with Nova Scotians to help them make their homes more energy efficient. Historically, we've always advertised the heating assistance rebate program when it begins in the fall, usually in late October. In 2011, we advertised the heating assistance rebate program in print and on radio in both French and English, and we also advertised it online. We sent out a press release on November 2nd, 2011, which received no pickup in the media at all. In January of this year, government was criticized for keeping the existence of the available heating assistance rebate quiet instead of outwardly promoting the program. Since the program was not earning any media coverage through press releases, the minister committed to investing in a second round of advertising to get the word out and to ensure as many Nova Scotians as possible received help through the program. To that end, we did a second round of print ads in February and March, again in French and English, and we added television spots to the campaign. The ads worked. In the last weeks of the campaign, requests for applications increased over the weeks preceding the advertisements. The Heating Assistance Rebate Program is a good, targeted initiative that helps thousands of Nova Scotians every year. But don't take our word for it. To assess the effectiveness of the Heating Assistance Rebate Program, department staff conducted a survey of past rebate clients, including clients who received the rebate in 2010, 2011, and a sample of clients who received the rebate in 2009, 2010, but who did not reapply the following year. The survey found general satisfaction with the program and the application process. 92% of those surveyed were satisfied with the program. Among those who did not reapply for the program, more than half cited changed or improved circumstances. According to survey respondents, awareness of the program came primarily from newspapers, approximately one-third of the respondents, and community groups, approximately one-fifth of the respondents. Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations also helps Nova Scotians heat their home through the Your Energy Rebate Program. Through this program, the entire provincial portion of the HST, 10%, is automatically taken off home heating bills. The department also works in partnership with the Salvation Army through its Good Neighbor Energy Fund. The Good Neighbor Energy Fund was started in 1997 by the Nova Scotia Power employees. The province came on board in 2008 and has made donations to the program every year since. The program runs from January to April and is administered by the Salvation Army. So as you can see, government has a number of programs in place to help Nova Scotians in need cope with the rising costs of home heating. These range from rebates to help making homes more energy efficient. And through initiatives like the Heating Assistance Rebate Program, we are committed to helping as many people as possible stay warm through the cold winter months. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll start our first round of questioning, but Mr. Younger, you have 20 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you. I just, could you, and I know you said this, I'm not sure if I heard them correctly. Could you tell me what the budget number or allocation was for, say, 2008, 2009 for HARP, and then 2000, I think it was 15 and then 14.9 or something like that. I just missed the exact numbers.
Yeah, for 2008-9, yeah. The budget was 29.3 million. The budget for 9-10 was 15 million. And the budget for 2010-11 and 11-12 was 14.9.
Okay, so when the rebate was dropped from 450, or maximum rebate was dropped from $450 to $200, the budget was cut in half, basically.
Generally speaking, yes.
Yeah, I mean, give or take a few numbers. Now, the minister has said repeatedly in the House that the reason for cutting the rebate in half, or more than half, from $450 to $200, was so that more people would be able to apply and it would be able to serve more people. That's the rationale she's given. But in fact, the budget's been cut in half. So can you answer that discrepancy? Because you're not gonna help that many more people if you cut the budget in half.
Okay, Cameron McNeil to respond.
Mr. McNeil.
When the changes were made to the program from the 2008-09 year, basically what occurred was the maximum allowance for heating oil was reduced from $450 to $200, and the allowance for non-oil heating applicants was increased from $150 to $200. Mm-hmm. And that basically brought the budget down by about $15 million, $14 million. As far as the application of the program went, none of the other parameters were changed. So the income and all of the threshold requirements remained the same with those changes. So it did increase, if you will. It was beneficial for those people that were not using oil but using electricity to heat their homes.
Yeah, because they could have, depending on their income, would have qualified for up to $50 more than the maximum that was there before, correct? So they went from $150 to $200 maximum potential rebate.
That's correct.
Yeah. I'm going to table, and since the chair asks for 100 copies of everything, I'll give you the 100
That's
copies.
That's correct. Mr. Younger?
This is data supplied by your department, so this isn't something that we pulled out of a hat. This was given to us by your department the other day, which actually shows that not only for oil, for example, when it went from 450 to 200, the number of applications and the number of rebates actually dropped. So the minister has spent the past 3 years saying that more people would be able to apply, more people would be helped, but actually, in real terms, the number is still lower than it was when the rebate was higher. So in 2008-2009, there were 61,000 applications and 54,000 were approved. In 2009-2010, the first year of the cut, there were 55,000 applications, which was 6,000 applications less. And obviously, some of those people might be people that just realized they didn't qualify, so more important is the rebates. There were actually 4,000 less rebates issued, and then oddly enough, last year it stayed basically the same, 50,000, but it's still lower than it was in 2008-2009, and so I'm just trying to reconcile two messages. The deputy minister had referenced the fact that the minister has been asked, it's two different ministers, I guess. It started with the previous minister when the cut was made, but was asked about this in house, and her rationale in question period was that more people would be able to be helped, but you are saying that the income cutoffs didn't actually change, so there's no more people who would have been eligible, right? So the only people on electricity or other non-oil sources of heat could conceivably have got $50 more as a rebate, but everybody else, anybody on oil, would have been $250 less, and so really this was about cutting the program budget.
Mr. McNeil?
Mr. Younger, it's difficult sometimes to answer these questions when they're out of context, and so you'll have to...
No, that's fine.
Another change that did occur generally with providing Nova Scotians with heating assistance in that year was the government changed the application of the Your Energy Rebate Program and made it more widely available by removing some limitations that had been placed upon the program for eligibility. And in essence, what the new incoming government did was provide a 10% rebate on the provincial sales tax for all electricity consumed in the province. And it is possible, I suppose, that, and it's a bit of conjecture on my part, I admit, yeah, but it is possible that the minister may have been referring to that
okay,
by doing that, it did expend heating assistance to
And I'm not trying to get you to explain the minister's comments. I'm just trying to put context around what it will. It wasn't a 10% reduction. It was an 8% reduction because it, and I know what you're, I know the semantics there, but the HST wasn't at 10, the provincial portion of the HST also wasn't at 10%, so it got raised at the same time. So it would have been an 8%. But I'm talking about oil at the moment, and the majority of households in Nova Scotia heat with oil, yes, according to data you know, I think everybody accepts that, but there's plenty of data out there that shows that the vast majority heat with oil. And that was reduced from $450 rebate to $200. And at the moment, we're still at 200, and the price of furnace oil is at record highs. It is never, as far as I can tell, it is never in the month of May, for example, or for the month of April, ever been as high per liter on average in Nova Scotia as it is right now. So it's less assistance, right? If I heat on oil and I'm low income, it's made it harder for me to, I can't, in some places won't even give me a minimum delivery of $200.
Mr. Malloy.
Again, there are a number of programs that were in put in place and taken away, and that's part of our annual budget process. The fact is that the oil allocation was reduced in 2009 in the first budget in the spring. And with the changes to the year energy rebate, which translate into on average savings of about $239, if you look at it from that perspective, the average person heating their home and assuming someone in low income category also receives that average, the refund or the benefit to them from the two programs combined would be about $439. The other benefit or the other program that we started down the path of in 2009, 2008-2009 timeframe was the Good Neighbor Energy Fund. And I think the trying to be responsive to those people who are most in need, you know, to your point, the increase that we gave or the amount of money that we gave to the Salvation Army to allow them to provide more funds to constituents out there who were in what we would consider perhaps dire or urgent need of support. We look at all of these as trying to address the whole situation and trying to be as responsive as possible. So I would contend that the deck chairs do move around sometimes and you know, they don't always come out equal and exactly where they began. But I would state that for the most part, I think we're not too far off what was originally the benefit of an oil heater in Nova Scotia. And with respect to the Good Neighbor Energy Program, there's an additional $350 available per person there. My understanding, and it's not our program, the Salvation Army program is not our program, we contribute to it. And my understanding is that initially, someone could benefit from that program once every 5 years. And because of the contribution that comes from the province, it's now down to enabling an individual to benefit once every 2 years. So from that point of view, clearly, there, you know, if you look at it over a longer period, someone is able to access far more funds for those people who are in urgent need of that. The other thing is, if you look at if someone is eligible for all three programs, which you know, clearly they're going to get the RNG rebate program if they pay heating costs. If they meet the income test for our program, they're going to be entitled to the $200. And if they meet the income test for the Salvation Army program, they're going to get an additional $350. So that equates to just under $800 of benefits that someone meeting the program criteria can access. And, you know, it certainly doesn't pay for all their heating costs, but, you know, the three programs, I think you have to look at it from the perspective of the three programs combined. And what we're trying to do is continually put that money in a situation where it can be accessed by the people who are in most desperate need of it.
Thank you. I don't have an expectation that all of somebody's heating costs are going to be able to be covered by government. I don't want to suggest that. But let me just say that, you know, you talked about the average savings of $239. It would actually be much, much less than $239 for somebody heating with oil. There's no way that they were spending $239 on the provincial portion of the HST on electricity in a year if they were heating. They would have probably more than that if they were heating with electricity, but they wouldn't have if they were heating with oil. So when we're talking about the oil people, they would be, because that is an average, as you said, they would be on the low end of that, and the people heating with electricity would be above 239, I would assume, and so you average those together and you get the 239. But even using your numbers, they're $20 less than they were getting before. The change in the Salvation Army, which you talk about from every 5 years to every 2 years, was already in place when $450 was available, because that happened in, it was either 2007 or 2008. I don't remember exactly which year it was, but it was before I was in this legislature. So that's the only reason I know that it was before then, is because it happened when I was on city council. So what we have is a situation where, like, from my perspective, if you're heating with oil, which is the vast majority of people, and even more the vast majority of low-income household owners, sometimes because of the age of the housing stock and so forth, they're actually in a worse position. The other element is that $350 that they can get from the Salvation Army, as you said, they can only get every 2 years. So. And that's, I guess, a product of the funding. And that funds run out twice. And in fairness, I know it was topped up at least once this year by the provincial government. So I want to recognize that. You don't. But it ran out again a few weeks ago. I can't remember the exact date, but it ran out a second time very quickly. And the word from them is the reason it's running out is because there's less money available now on the heating rebate from the province. So. It's almost like a downloading to the Salvation Army program for people that heat with oil. And so I guess what I'm just trying to understand, like, even with your own average, the amount available between 2008 and 2009 has dropped for somebody heating with oil. There's even using the average number and not saying it's lower, that it's the total amount available, including the Salvation Army and everything else, has dropped. So I'm just trying to understand what the rationale was, whether it was simply just a budget issue that, listen, the province is in bad shape, we got to save money, we're going to cut this program in half, which is basically what happened in terms of the budget item, or whether there was another rationale, because whichever way you add up the numbers, between 2008 and 2009, a low-income family heating with oil, when they take all the programs combined, has access to less rebate in 2009 and today than they did in 2008, and heating oil prices are higher. So I'm just trying to understand, yeah. Like, and if it was a budget thing, that's a government decision, right? But I just try and understand, was it just a budget thing, or is there some other reason why? There's got to be a rationale there where somebody said, okay, this is the right thing to do.
Mr. Malloy?
My understanding is, first of all, that in 2008, when we were providing the initial grants to the Good Neighbor Energy Fund, it was a five-year program. People were only eligible every 5 years. It was only after a couple years of funding from the province that they took it down to a three-year rotation, and then subsequently two-year rotation. So we're working with the Salvation Army because, in fact, we found out recently as well that they were running low on money. And we've asked them for a bit of a report on what happened and why their take-up has increased. Just anecdotally, what I've heard is not that there's a downloading from the province, but that the program is being better known, better understood. And with the second, with going to the two-year rotation, the second year has more people eligible for it because of the way the program came in. So they're in that second year cycle where they're going to get more applicants for it, and just generally they're picking up more people for the first go around. So I say, I don't have any, I've not spoken to anybody from Salvation Army. We do intend to meet with them and get better information around that. Around the budget, I can really, somewhat surmise that in 2009 it was actually the conservative government that brought in the budget where the HARP program was reduced from a $29 to a $14 million budget. That one was not passed, but the my understanding at that time was it was an affordability. Government's been under restraint for some time and had to make tough decisions. The fact when the budget was passed in September of that year, the reason I suspect the government didn't, bring the rebates back to where they were is because of the changes that they made to the Your Energy Rebate Program to provide the savings to a broader number of people through the rebate and the provincial sales tax. And like you say, does the average lower income person get that average of 239 or do they get something different? I really don't have any information to demonstrate one way or the other. I suspect that you're probably right. They're probably on the lower side, not the higher side. But I do believe that if you were to do the math and look at the fact that I receive today my portion of the Your Energy Rebate, and I'm eligible for an annual grant of the provincial heating assistance rebate program, and perhaps I'm eligible for the Good Neighbor Energy Fund rebate program every second year, I think if you look at it over a 5 or 6 year period, and I have not done the math, I'm just going here, I would say that they potentially could be even a little better off than they were under only receiving the rebate from the Good Neighbor Energy Program once every 5 years. Because that's actually a $350 grant, so that's fairly substantive.
Yeah, and if it would, depending on when that change happened, and I will check, I was pretty sure it happened before, but you could be right, and I'll check. And I don't disagree with you that some of the, I think there are a number of factors that contribute to the Salvation Army program running out, and I think the ones that you addressed also do factor in that. I mean, I can tell you, I have a substantial percentage of low-income families that would qualify for this rebate in my constituency. We go through a heck of a lot of these applications in a year, and in fact, so much so that we actually distribute them to there's some independent oil companies in around my riding that we distribute them to as well, so that they can hand them out to the customers that they know are going to qualify, and it gets it out to a few more people. They might get them also from you at the same time, who knows, but at least they have it. But I do know that some of those people can't say, well, listen, like, you know, they won't even deliver me $200 because the minimum is $250. And I will, like, between everybody speaking, I will check to see when that Salvation Army change was, because you might be right, but I was pretty sure it had changed before that. And you're right, part of that was because the province at some point started contributing some money now and again to that. So I do recognize that that was one of the things that allowed them to do that, and Nova Scotia Power contributed a bit more and so forth. And I also give Mel Bootler at Parker Street a bit of credit because he raised a bit of hell over that issue. Sorry if that's unparliamentary, but Mr. Chair. But very briefly, I would just say that I think that there is a question as to whether that should, have you ever looked at linking the rebate amounts somehow to the average price of furnace oil or something like that? Because it seems random, right? Like it seems like, okay, well the price went, it's buying power, right? And this isn't about, well, you need $200 to buy groceries, which also go up in price, but this is the fact that heating oil has been on the rise on average.
Mr. Malloy.
Yes. To your question, no, we have not looked at attaching some type of inflationary or deflationary measure to the program in relation to the cost of home heating oil or electricity. The overall program.
I'm going to run out of time. I just want to interrupt you. No. The Salvation Army just told us that it was never 5 years.
They just order. Order, please. Thank you, Mr. Younger's time has expired. Okay. Mr. McMaster.
Chair. My first question, and we've spoken already about it a bit today, there was a decrease from the 2008-09 year to the 2009-2010 year. Why was the rebate decreased so drastically?
Mr. McMaster or Mr. McNeil?
Could you repeat the question for me, please?
She's saying the changes from 2008-09 to 2009-10, there was a significant decrease in the amount of rebate.
That's correct.
What was sort of the, what led up to that decision?
We were directed, in the lead up to the budget process, the finalization of the budget by the prior government, we were directed that monies would be reduced for the program to by approximately one half to 14.9. So it was really an affordability issue.
Right. So, and how have you found the change now that it's been reduced? Is it the number of applicants is the same, but it's, I guess it is saving the government money because the government's not putting out as much money.
That's correct. With the reduced allowances, the program has come in at less money, and also we're seeing a sort of a consistent take up over the 3 years since the budget was reduced.
Okay. We see that the price of oil has been increasing. I noticed I was looking at the price of it yesterday. It's actually down a little bit, but. Has there been any discussion in the department about the rebate being offered currently relative to the change in the price of oil from that point in time until now?
Each year, Mr. McMaster, as we approach the fall, there's a review done on the program, and consideration is, you know, things such as the price of oil, price of electricity, and so forth is considered. And we look at our budget situation, and options are presented for consideration. And basically from there, program parameters are set or maintained.
Is, from your experience, is it, I get the sense that a lot of it is dependent on the government's ability to provide a rebate.
That's correct.
There's not a lot of analysis of what the homeowner is facing in terms of energy costs. It's just, there was a round number chosen, and it's kind of changed a bit over the years, but it's basically based on the government's ability to afford to provide the rebate.
I would say affordability is definitely the dominant factor. However, I think consideration is also given to the other circumstances, such as where the price of oil stands, where the price of electricity stands, what the changes have been over the past year, and so forth.
Okay. When we look at the rebate that's offered, and I know that if you're a single person, you get your rebate, it would be different than, say, a person that's say two people cohabitating. The income barriers are different.
That's correct.
Would it make sense that if there are two people applying together, that there may, and if there's, you know, there's possibility there could be children in the home as well, would it make sense that their power needs might be greater than, say, a single person living in a single dwelling? I guess what I'm getting at is, has there been thought put into determining the rates for somebody who's single versus, say, a couple of people that are cohabitating who may have children and may have higher energy needs and may really have a need for a higher rebate?
Yes, and I suppose that's why we have a sort of a single rate and a family rate. So we have, you know, a $27,000 maximum income threshold for single, and $42,000 maximum income threshold for families.
So I guess I think what I'm trying to get at here is if in the where there's more people living in the home, there's more energy being consumed, it would stand to reason that they may be eligible for more of a rebate if we were trying to be fair to everybody. But I don't sense that there's ever been much consideration for that.
I can't say that we've looked at options where the rebate would be linked to the number of occupants in the home. No.
Sure. Okay. Removing the HST, of course, is good for everybody. Nobody is going to complain about having to pay less tax on their power bill. And that was, I guess, good for all Nova Scotians because all Nova Scotians are paying the HST. But also more beneficial to those who use a lot of energy. People say with larger homes, for instance. What was the reasoning behind giving such a tax break to the general population while at the same time reducing the amount that's being offered through the rebate?
you know, you'd really have to, I don't know the rationale behind that. I wasn't a party to those discussions. It was a decision made really in the prior administration.
Right.
Because the budget that was brought in by the current government was really just a continuation of when it came to the HARP program, a continuation of what was proposed in the initial budget that was voted down.
Okay.
The I believe that the current government did come into office with a promise to expand the application of the Your Energy Rebate Program, and that's what they did. So I'm not sure if there was sort of a linked consideration of the two, if you will.
Sure.
Have you experienced any, because the program's been around for a few years now, have you experienced any efficiencies in the way the program is delivered?
Efficiencies? Oh, yes.
Can you explain some of those?
Well, actually, when the program was initially offered under the Keep the Heat banner, we had a review done, and out of that review, there were several suggestions made how we could make the program, how we could make the administration of the program more efficient and have better controls in place. All of those things were implemented. We actually developed a rebate system to facilitate the delivery of the program, and as a direct result of that, we saw things such as reduced turnaround times. I think initially we were looking at anywhere from 8 to 10 weeks before the person would actually get their check from the program. That's been reduced to 6 to 8 weeks and less in many instances, depending upon the how complete the application is with all of the and the associated documentation. So we've seen considerable improvements in that area, and just generally automating processes that were once manual. The one of the benefits of our program is that an individual is required to produce proof of income to qualify, and sometimes this documentation can get lost and so forth, and it presents a challenge to the individual. Well, our program has a direct link to CRA, and we can actually, through electronic means, determine if, so long as the person approves and gives us full permission to do it, we can contact CRA and get the proof of income, just on the power of their tick to a box sort of thing, and so that was a major step ahead. The other thing is on the notification of the program, we send out pre-populated application forms to prior year participants, and it makes it very easy for them to get back into the new program, if you will, through simply checking a box and signing a few things and getting them back in. So yeah, we've seen considerable efficiencies on the administrative side.
That's great. And I guess when the example with the Revenue Canada connection, you're in a way you're helping to remove a barrier for people who are trying to make application, which I think is great. Is there any other barriers that people have found that you've been seeing as the process has been being improved along the way? Are there any other barriers that have been removed or that you foresee removing in the future to making it easier for people who are applying?
Anytime you work with an application-based program, you often get feedback that the folks, your target audience, have difficulty with the documentation or so forth. And that was a major challenge for us at the outset of the heating assistance program, and particularly the Keep the Heat program, which was its immediate predecessor. We took that situation in hand. We met with community groups. We met with folks who could assist us in making the application form as user-friendly as possible, so that the folks that the target group that this program is intended for could easily understand and complete the form and get it back to us with a minimum of frustration. We also worked collaboratively with social work groups, social workers, and social community groups get them to lend their assistance to folks who wanted to participate in this program but might be challenged due to educational background or so forth. And I think we've done a pretty good job. We're quite pleased. The survey results, we did a survey of folks who participated in the program last year, 200 people who participated in the program, and 200 people who were not successful in participating in the program due to not meeting the eligibility criteria. And the results back were quite impressive. We got a 92% satisfaction rate back on that survey. And so we, yeah, it's I think it's indicative that the program has come a long way from its initial introduction.
That's good. It's good to see the communication between the people, finding out if they're benefiting and if there's any challenges they face. So that's good. And I guess I was just kind of thinking about the numbers in my head. The program last year was, I think the costs were a little above $10 million last year. I guess I was just thinking if the program, if things are becoming more efficient, there'd be some savings there that might be able to be passed on to increasing the rebate. But I know the savings, if you translate into an increase in the rebate, it might only be $5 or $10 more per year for people. But has there been any consideration of trying to increase the rebate after saving costs and making the program more efficient?
We actually have reduced the amount of administrative budget by, I believe, about $200,000 from $900,000. Which is a pretty significant cut, you know, when you look at it on a percentage basis. However, I think it's also important to point out that this is done, those adjustments were made in the larger context of fiscal restraint. And it's a, you know, sort of, it's a fiscal decision of government, how those savings get reallocated.
Sure, sure. Maybe they find their way into the Salvation Army program, for instance, or something like that. Yeah, okay. And speaking of that, the Good Neighbor Energy Fund that's distributed by the Salvation Army, is the waiting list around 200 people on that program?
On the Salvation Army program?
Yes. I can appreciate perhaps you wouldn't have the information on that. Okay.
I don't know the answer to that.
Maybe this question is irrelevant, but I was going to ask, is there any work being done to decrease that list? And I guess to decrease it, you need to provide more funding into the program. But is there any discussion on that in your offices?
What I can say about the our support of the Salvation Army program is this, is that generally, we communicate back and forth throughout the course of the program and determine where things stand. Up until this year, the program, the Salvation Army program, either had some surplus funding left at the end of the year or were in pretty good shape overall. This year, to my knowledge, is the first year that the Salvation Army program came up short as early as they did in the cycle of their program. And when they notified us, we immediately conveyed that information on to our minister and so forth. And that resulted in an additional appropriation, if you will, or grant of $400,000. When they ran out the second time, which was very late in the cycle of their program, we were not aware that they had reached that point where the funds had been depleted.
Okay. Have you considered partnering with Efficiency Nova Scotia to, and maybe it's by way of on the application forms, when people are applying for rebates, their attention is piqued, you know, they're focused on getting the rebate. There's certainly immediate value for them in it. Have you considered partnering with Efficiency Nova Scotia to try to promote their programs that would be specifically to help people on low or fixed incomes to consider taking advantage of other government programs to reduce their energy usage so that it would, I know if people are saving a couple hundred dollars a year, but the price of energy is going up, and that seems to be the general trend, especially now with the changes in the energy policy, if those people were able to take advantage of programs offered by the demand side management charge on our power bills, it might help to offset the ongoing increases in power rates in the province. So I guess just to put the question around it again, have you considered partnering with Efficiency Nova Scotia to try to promote those programs, with the end goal being to reduce the cost of energy on Nova Scotians?
Actually, Mr. McMaster, when we initially introduced Keep the Heat, one of the main components of that program involved a partnership with what was then called Conserve Nova Scotia. And you might recall that we had some, you know, boxes of compact fluorescent lights and aerators and sort of energy saving devices and material that was distributed in that program. And the idea was not only to, you know, provide folks with some money to help them with the increase in heating costs, but also to save some money through efficiencies. That theme has carried through into the current program, and basically we do a couple of things. First of all, on the application form, we ask the applicant if they would like us to share their information with Efficiency Nova Scotia, and that the information may indeed be used to qualify them for programs that are offered by Efficiency Nova Scotia directly. And Efficiency Nova Scotia then takes this information and they'll make some contact in many cases, and they you know, it could very well lead to sort of a range of things occurring, from, you know, some information being sent out to the individuals, to actual grants being provided to the individuals to improve the energy efficiency of their home. In addition to that, right at the point of application, we actually give a brochure that is published by Efficiency Nova Scotia. So that's kind of a long answer, I guess, to say yes, we partner with Efficiency Nova Scotia, and as a matter of fact, we also try to partner through consultation and work through other groups such as community services to get the word out, and also we've worked with the Ecology Action Center from time to time when we were developing the forms and so forth for the program.
Okay, that's great. What about for people, the area I represent is a rural area, and some people find ways to procure their own sources of energy. It might be paying somebody to cut some wood for them, that kind of thing. They might have a wood stove. How do people like that access the rebate program?
Well, if they buy their wood, they provide us with a receipt for the purchase of the wood, and they qualify, and they're eligible for the $200 rebate. If they cut their own wood, then there is a process in place where they can submit documentation and signed declarations that they use wood to heat their home, and they would qualify for the rebate as well.
Okay, that's great. It's good that the program is flexible to be able to help those people. Mr. Chair, how much time do I have left?
You have less than a minute.
I think I'll conclude with that and carry on in the next session.
Great, thank you. Mr. Wynot.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and glad to see everyone here today. Thank you for coming. I know oftentimes in this chamber and in this committee, some members like to make up numbers and timelines, and so I just want to take us back a step in time here. Were you provided with the copy of the piece of paper that Mr. Younger passed around? Okay. In 2004-05 and 05-06, we have Keep the Heat program. Then we jump a couple of years to 08-09. When was the Keep the Heat? Because I remember there was 1 year that the Keep the Heat program, in one aspect of it, was canceled. Can you tell me what year there was a time when the Keep the Heat program was it not the case that there was a rebate for a removal of, you could apply to get, you know, a portion of the HST removed from your power bill. Can someone comment on that? What was the Keep the Heat program around that time?
Mr. McNeil.
Okay. I think that there's sort of two distinct programs at play in your thinking. There's the Your Energy Rebate Program and the Keep the Heat, which became the HARP program. So, but they are sort of distinct programs.
Okay.
And yes, in the Your Energy Rebate Program, there was a scale back of the rebate that was offered for the consumption of electricity. And the rationale behind that scale back was that the government of the day, I guess, looking at the affordability issue that they were looking at, scaled the application of the rebate back to what was considered to be the heating portion of the electricity bill. And that was the scale back for the
year. What year was that in?
I'm going to say 809.
Okay. So in that time, just by looking at this sheet that was provided to us, we had $23 million for HARP, the new version of HARP, or I guess at that time it would have been a new program, correct? Like it went from Keep the Heat to HARP.
I'm sorry.
In 0809.
0809, yes, there was a transition from Keep the Heat to...
Okay. So in that year, Nova Scotians saved approximately $23 million, those who had applied through HARP. Those who were eligible through HARP saved about $23 million on their heating bills.
They were provided...
With a rebate.
That's right, rebates of $23 million. Dollars.
What other programs in that year on top of HARP were in existence?
The Your Energy Rebate Program in modified form.
Right, and how much was that approximately? How much in the budget year, you know?
See, it's difficult to say because I transition back and forth. I don't think I can give you a qualified answer to that question. Okay. I mean, basically, it's a rebate program, and so therefore, it's really something that's sort of a contra revenue. And dealt with by the Department of Finance. That's my first reasoning. And the second reasoning is because we had sort of a fit and start to that program, we had the reduction, but then when the new government came in, they changed it. So I'm not sure if we had a full.
Okay. So then in 2009-10, the program HARP was saved about Nova Scotians about $11 million off their heating. Those who are eligible for HARP saved about $11 million on their heating bills.
They were given grants of about $11 million, dollars, yes.
Plus the HST removal in that budget year, which I think started in September of that year?
That's correct.
Okay. How much was that in 2009-10?
The program cost or program allowance was $52.8 million for 2009-10.
Okay, so at this point, we're saving approximately $53.8 million. Nova Scotia saved approximately $53.8 million in 2009-10.
Are you combining the both?
Yeah, combining the two.
My math tells me about
63.8. Great. Then in 10-11,
yes,
from the numbers that are provided here, Nova Scotians saved $10.5 million, those who are eligible for HARP,
correct,
plus the HST removal. Now, that's a full year of the HST removal. And how much was that?
$87.5
million. $87.5 million. So that's approximately $98 million Nova Scotians saved on their power bills.
On energy.
That's correct.
On energy.
Mr. Wynott, sorry, I'm referring to the chart.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
And to your earlier question now, I can state that the 8-9 savings from the Europe was about $49 million.
49, okay. Thank you. And then in, I guess we don't really have the table for this, but in 11-12, it'd be approximately about the same, I would say, I would assume, as far as combining the two programs. Will be about $98 million savings to Nova Scotians.
It's about $11.9 million expenditure for the HARP program, and for the Your Energy Rebate program, because I think we're getting into sort of an increased rebate due to the changes in the HST. And the provincial portion of the HST, and it's a $102.2 million program.
So in 11-12, 102, you said, was the HST removal?
102.2.
So in fact, Nova Scotians saved another $113 million on their power bills, on the energy bills.
I would say
combining those two programs.
I would say $114 million.
So if I'm correct. In 09-10, with those two programs combined, Nova Scotians saved $63.8 million on their energy programs, on their energy bills. In 10-11, Nova Scotians saved $98 million on their energy bills. And in 11-12, Nova Scotians saved $113.2 million on their energy bills. Is that correct?
That's what the numbers would say.
Then on top of this, what's interesting is then on top of that, in fact, a couple of weeks ago, we had Efficiency Nova Scotia here. And they, one of the CEO of Efficiency Nova Scotia, in fact, said that because of the programs that Efficiency Nova Scotia run, Nova Scotians saved last year alone $100 million. So if we add those two programs, those three programs, or three kind of envelopes of money together, Nova Scotians, in fact, in last year, saved $213.2 million on their energy bills. I want to point that out for the record to the opposition, $213.2 million in energy savings. Mr. McKinnon, I believe it's your turn.
Mr. McKinnon.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Looking back to the initial program where the allocation, the rebate was $50, and we had 17,500 actually get rebates. And we've evolved over the years to the last three, in fact, where there have been over 50,000 rebates. I'm wondering if you have any statistics on 2011-2012, because we're well into the year.
I do.
And still a lot more applications to process, no doubt.
There's about 1,000 more applications to process. I know that off the top of my head, but I have to find the... Do you have the other chart? Mr. McKinnon, just to be certain, so you're asking if I have stats for the last 3 years for the program?
No, we have the stats for the last 3 years. Okay. I'm just wondering where we are right now in this year, how many we've looked after through the program.
Okay, so we have received 55,119 applications that have been entered into the system. We have approved 51,091 of those applications, and the checks have been sent or in the process of being sent. We have declined about 3,092 applications, and I think if you work the math through, I did this last night, that means that there's about 1,000 applications that are pending in the system.
So we're going to be higher than the last 2 years at least?
We are.
Okay. Now, I'm wondering, did HARP use all of the monies allocated to it in past years?
No, it has not.
Can you sort of recap how we've done each year, if not, why not?
Okay. How far back would you like me to go?
3 or 4 years.
Okay. So in...
Or to the beginning of Keep the Heat.
Beginning of Keep the Heat.
I'm just wondering about monies left over.
Mr. McKinnon, I can go back with what's here in front of me.
Sure.
To 08-09, and that's the initial HARP program. And we had a budget of about $29 million. We spent about $23 million that year. In 09-10, we had a budget of $14.9 million. We spent $11 million. In 10-11, we had a budget of $14.9 million, and we spent about $10.5 million. And then this year, we're headed for, we had 14.9 going into the year, and it looks like we're headed for just over 12 million, about 12.1.
So we're looking at an increase there. One of the things that I have found difficult with some people, and it's even worse with some of the housing grants, because there is a substantial amount of money we're dealing with, thousands of dollars. And when someone is slightly over, like for example, if someone in fact showed an income of $27,006, they don't qualify because it is a rigid program. I've always advocated, particularly with some of the other programs where you're talking thousands of dollars, that there might be some consideration someday of that person perhaps having a little clawback and receiving $194 or something like that, right? I mean, you couldn't have this going for any great distance because you're only talking $200, but I find in my constituency office, somebody says, well, I'm just a few dollars over, and it's very disheartening for them. I'm just wondering if there's ever been any consideration to that.
There has, and I think it's noteworthy, Mr. McKinnon, to say that perhaps the most challenging part of administering this program is when we encounter those situations where someone is hard up against the line, just over the line, and we have to decline. And I know a lot of consideration goes into what we can do to increase income thresholds so that we can help more people with this program. And that occurs, as I said, every fall when we look at it. The thresholds that were established are based upon LICO, low income cutoff, as stated for Stats Canada, for Nova Scotia. We initially, when the program was introduced, we took those LICO income levels, and that's what we used. Then we took an average between the urban and the rural LICO lines, and that worked in the favor of applicants. And we rounded up wherever we could. So I can say that, you know, there's genuine desire to try to increase the capture of the program. As far as the roll-off goes, and that is, you know, the absolute threshold, what we did, to qualify for the full allowance for this program, your income can't be over $25,000 for single or $40,000 for family. And what we established was a sort of an off-ramp or a roll-off that for every $500 of income over that threshold, we would reduce your check by $50. And the reason we didn't do it sort of dollar for dollar is that if you did it that way, then somebody earned $46,998, we'd be sending them a check for $2, and that would be kind of insulting, I think, and not very efficient. So we did it in blocks of 50. So for every $500 in income increment, we would reduce the allowance by $50. And that was that kind of feathering to the threshold was done for exactly the reason that you just noted.
Thank you for explaining that. One of the other problems that I've run into a number of times, and I would like to have aired as well, is with the wood rebate, we have all kinds of situations where I bought my wood from my brother-in-law and I don't have a receipt, and we say, well, you must have a receipt. So the person goes back and usually gets a receipt and tries to resolve this. My constituency is by and large rural, and I run into this quite often. And something that you indicated that I would like to have clarified is that a person can actually cut his or her own wood and still qualify, which is something that I think you just stated, and that's sort of an area I'd like to explore because that happens quite often.
Before we will approve a rebate under those circumstances, we require the individual to provide us with a sworn affidavit that that indeed they cut their own wood and use it. But yes, we will provide the rebate with that proviso.
That's very comforting, I think, to know that there is that kind of flexibility within the program for sure. Getting the message out is something we've heard a lot about, and I think you've improved the situation there considerably. And it's my understanding that you actually distributed 13,000 more applications this year than in the past. So I believe you're doing a very good job in that regard. And it seems that from the survey that you did, most people that became aware of the program, the newspaper was the best approach in return, right? I'm wondering, and the fact that you send out the application to everyone who qualified before is excellent, and that reaches so many people. But there are still some people who are not aware of the program, and I don't know how we reach them. You try everything imaginable, and I think you've even tried to get some freebies with sending some releases out to newspapers, and there isn't much uptake on those. Is there anything else that we can, in fact, be doing?
If there is, it escapes me. And we're certainly open for suggestions. With this program, at one point or another, we've done everything from advertise on buses, advertise on radio, both English and French, newspapers across the province, rollies, on the, what they call rollies on the TV, and we've done TV adverts. We've promoted the program at the grassroots level through community groups, through the Salvation Army, through food banks, through all the MLA.
Order, sorry, Mr. McKinnon's time has expired. Mr. Younger, you have 16 minutes in the second round.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you. I want to start with a clarification. So Salvation Army just called back, and there are, when they first called and said that it was never 5 years, it was 5 years back when the rebate was 250, but when it was 450, it was 3 years. So it was 5 years significantly further back, but when we're, but it was at a three-year, every three-year period in 08, 09, when the available assistance from the government was 450. So you could get 450 plus 350 plus, assuming it was a year that you were eligible for, 450 plus 350 plus, plus actually, as you just said to Mr. Wynot, plus in the low income group, you could get the HST back. So now you can get 450, or no, now you can get 200 plus 350 plus the HST back. So if you're in that low income group, your net amount available is less than it was before. If your income's under 27,000 and you're eligible, and it's a year that you're eligible for the Salvation Army Good Neighbor Fund, your assistance that you could potentially get back is $250 less than it was in 2009 or 8-9, because I know we're on fiscal years.
I'm going to have to break that down a bit, Mr. Younger, sure that I, you know, so on the Good Neighbor program, I think just to sort of put a lock on it.
Yep.
When we provided a donation of $400,000 to the Good Neighbor program, their cycle was a five-year cycle. Mm-hmm. And they then moved to alter their rules. And I can't say with clarity, with total clarity, when that occurred, whether it occurred in the first year or not, yeah. But I can tell you that when the
I'm sure that's why
when that donation was yeah. done, and I think the deputy was answering yeah. to that question.
I'm sure you're right that's what allowed them to do that. I don't dispute that at all. Yeah. I think you're probably absolutely right on that. Right. What I'm talking about is the year, and the year that happened, you could still get 450 from the government. And according to the government's own press releases on the site, it says that was because heating oil prices had spiked to, ironically enough, they had spiked to 91.7 cents, and now they're like 99 cents. So, and then the following year it was reduced to $200, and the government gave $800,000, according to the government's website. So, all I'm really just pointing out is. The member for Hammonds Plains Upper Sackville just talked about all these other amounts and the totals, but those are, we're talking about low income, a program for low income families, and the numbers he's giving apply to millionaires. So today we're here talking about the HEART program, which you have to have a single income of under 27,000 or a family income of under 42,000. And for that group of people, between what was available when there was a 400, if they heated with oil, the amount of assistance available to them today versus the year before that change went in, the year after that change is $200 less. And we can debate all the reasons. But I just sort of wanted to clarify that, because even on the efficiency Nova Scotia changes, the member's absolutely right. There's $100 million in savings of energy efficiency to people and businesses of all income groups, but that also cost ratepayers $43 million to pay for that instead of shareholders paying for that. And that's another department, not your worry, so I won't even get you to, because it's not your department, I won't get you to answer that. The one thing I will ask about is, Ider asked you earlier about the minister and the reason, and so I'm going to table Hansard here, and I apologize, Mr. Chair, I only have one copy because we just printed it now because it came up earlier, but maybe some copies can be made.
I'll get the clerk to make copies.
The minister had said, it was Minister, it's Minister Jennings, and I know I'm not supposed to use names, but I just want to indicate it was the previous minister to the minister who is now, had stated in the House that one of the reasons that this was being done, she acknowledged that part of it was a budget cut. But one of the reasons she said this was being done is because they would then be able to assist 70,000 families instead of 54,000. And that's the number she uses in her response. Mm-hmm. But here we are, we've gone from 54, instead of going from 54 to 70, we've gone from 54 to 50. Do you know where that 70,000 number came from? Because
I do.
Okay.
It came from myself as one of the staff members that were involved in putting together the estimates. Yes, that was a number that we believed illustrated the potential of where this program could go, and that's what it was funded up to.
Okay, and so it hasn't gone there, obviously.
No, it hasn't.
That's fine. I know you make estimates, and estimates work out, they don't work out. But one of the minister had said that, you know, we're gonna fund 70,000 people at $200, like round numbers, okay? Which works out to, somebody can quickly do the math.
$200 per.
Thank you. I just don't want to say, it'd be embarrassing to say that, do the math and get the number wrong. That didn't work out. It has been pretty stable by the looks of things, of 50,000 rebates given out each year since. So that's, my colleague next to me says it's 51 this year, but so 50,000-ish. The numbers we got from your department for last year were 50,000, but 50-51. Have you considered, since the program was intended to be funded for 70,000 people at $200, and you are consistently now getting 50 or 51,000 people, have you considered increasing the rebate by a proportional amount to use those funds to support low-income families that you had intended to use anyway?
That was certainly an option that was calculated, but again, I think it comes down to affordability.
But you'd already budgeted for 70,000 people.
Well, this is the first time that we can sit with some comfort on those numbers, because prior to, there's been a three-year run now with a stable program where we've used the same income factors and the same allowances and so forth. And I think that you'll see that, 50, 52,000 is a very consistent uptake on the program. So we have some comfort. Now, that sort of explains a bit of why we left a bit of a margin on top of the what we expected the program to consume. It's very difficult to estimate what the uptake will be in the absence of that experience, because I can go to Stats Canada and I can tell you how many households there are by income in the province of Nova Scotia. And I can go to Nova Scotia Power, and I can get a pretty good idea of how many households heat with electricity in the province of Nova Scotia, and I can also go to Stats Canada and find out, how many heat with oil. Right? What I don't have is something that ties all of those numbers together. So it becomes a bit of a guessing game to some extent, because then you also have to tie it into, home ownership as a proxy for who's paying for their own heat versus somebody who's renting and not paying for their own heat directly, and so forth. We now have the 3 years. We now have a consistent number, around 50,000, and so forth. We've looked at various options and iterations, how we could change this program. At the end of the day, it does come down to, I think, the fact that government has made a decision that it's made changes to the your energy rebate program, the rebate made in those programs, and that's been a considerable revenue cost. It's supporting the Salvation Army, and it's investing in efficiency programs and so forth. And so it basically is looking at the affordability issue, and it's saying, well, we can't put more money out. And actually this year, the budget's been decreased for HARP down to $13.1 million. And that's, there's still a bit of a margin there to allow for potential for more take up in the program. But it's hardening, those numbers are starting to harden.
I don't have any criticism for estimating it at 70,000 people originally. I mean, you're right, you have to make an estimate. So I don't criticize the minister for saying that, listen, we're assuming, because that was from when the change was made. Listen, we're gonna do it 70,000, we think it's 70,000 people will take this. I guess my concern is that, the Your Energy Rebate Program, I didn't even know the HSD reduction had a program name. now I do. But that HST reduction is great, except for if I was low income, I was getting it anyway, in a roundabout way. I mean, it was done in a different way, and I understand that, because that's what Mr. The member for Hammonds Plains Upper Sackville was asking about earlier. And I know that that's a very big budget line item. I understand that. It's a budget, big budget line item, in part because of everybody. It's you want to correct something.
Well, just
I can
before tell, you
and that's okay. I want to let you correct something if I'm misunderstanding it.
Actually, there was if you heat it with oil, there's a good chance that you didn't get a rebate on your electricity before the latest changes were made. If you were in a low income group, the reason being is that the threshold that was set, which would exclude you from the rebate, was set on the basis that you didn't heat with electricity, and so. But now by removing that, then you get a rebate on all the electricity that you consume. So therefore, you would get benefit from the removal of the threshold. So yes, yeah. Indeed, you would benefit.
Well, you're right. You're right. There would be potentially, and we will never know how much that benefit is, and because what's happened is they've a low income family that heated with oil is now receiving $250 less. There is no way that if $239 is the average that everybody is getting as a result of that HST change, obviously when you do an average, there are people at the bottom end and people at the top end, and the people at the top end are going to be the people who heat with electricity because obviously they use more electricity. And then you average that in with the people that don't heat with electricity, and that's what happens, is you end up with the average of 239. But even if they did get the 239 average, you're still getting $20 less at the end of the day. So I can use the $200 oil rebate, the $239 average HST rebate they now get, and I'll use the average, even though I think that's probably generous for someone that heats with oil, but we'll use the average because we can at least agree on that number. And then I'll add the $350 they get for Salvation Army. And even under that scenario, they're getting $21 less, and oil is 10 cents if you're lucky, and you can afford to pay cash and you don't have to go to Irving or something, you're paying 21, and you can get someone to deliver that small amount of oil. You're paying 11 cents a liter more for oil. And so, ish. And I know it fluctuates, depends where you buy it, but when the minister was talking about this, it was like 90 cents a liter or something, and I know because I filled up, and I always hunt around for the cheapest one. I filled up the other day, it was like 98 and a half or 99 and a half. It was almost a buck. Mm-hmm. So they're paying more for oil, and even by the most generous numbers, they're getting $21 less in potential assistance. That's where I think that's where I'm trying to say the problem is. And so what I'm saying is that the government had always assumed that 70,000 people would take up this program, and they didn't. And I don't criticize the I don't want this misinterpreted. I'm not criticizing the 70,000 estimate. I understand where it came from, that's fine. But it was budgeted at some point to that amount. And I just, what I'm saying is I think there was an opportunity to help more low-income families. Maybe it would have allowed an extra $25 on the program. I know it wouldn't have been huge, but I think there was an opportunity. Instead, what we've seen is oil prices have gone up. The budget for the program has actually gone down. And that doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me when you're trying to help low-income families who are struggling under electricity costs, and not only oil, I might add, because I know this program also helps people with electricity. Electricity costs have risen 20% in 3 years, 40% in 10 years, more than 40%, but I'll be generous and say 40%. That's where I don't understand the rationale, because it's a program designed to help low-income families who are obviously the ones who are most impacted by increasing prices, and yet the budget for the program has decreased at the same time that the costs and the amount, the income cutoff and everything else has stayed flat at a time when all those costs it's trying to help people with are actually increasing, which means the amount of money that, the amount of buying power that they're getting for that amount of rebate is actually decreasing, right?
Mr. Mullo.
If I could just make a comment. First of all, going back and forth here in the Blackberry, and I think it's all in how you ask the question sometimes, but what we've heard is that...
Order, please. Unfortunately, Mr. Younger's time has expired.
I wanted the
Mr. Porter.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Mr. Malloy, please carry on. I'm going to give you an opportunity to answer that because I'm quite interested in the numbers as well, so please feel free to carry on with your comment.
Thank you. The interesting thing is that it's all, like I said, it's all how you ask the question, and our staff are saying that in 2008-09, the policy of Salvation Army was every 5 years, and that decreased as funding became available, and I've got contact information that I can share with your staff here on who we talk to. You know, and I guess that the number game, you really have to sit down and go through, and there's so many variables and so many unknown pieces of information, it's impossible to come to a number we'll ever agree upon. I do believe that with the Salvation Army grant being available more frequently, that in total, someone in the most dire need or urgent need of support is getting better support by having us, you know, put that money into the Salvation Army than to put $25 onto everybody's check. And to me, it is, you know, the program, there's got to be a certain amount of flexibility there from our department's perspective, and having some funds available to us just helps us ensure that we are doing our very best to help those people in urgent needs.
Thank you for that answer, Mr. Malloy. And I got a few questions, and whoever wishes to answer, Mr. McNeil, Mr. Malloy, or whomever in your panel is fine, and I appreciate you being with us today, because this is an important topic that we're talking about here, and I think it's worth looking back at to see how well we're doing or how we're not doing and how we can do it better. I think that it's good. We're very fortunate that prior government had put a plan in place, and if we continue to build on that or whatever we do with it, I think we need to think about that, because it's the people out there that we're helping that do matter here, and I think sometimes that gets lost. And I know coming from an area in the Valley, there have been a lot of people that have been in applying for this thing, and I did hear maybe Mr. Malloy in your opening comments early on, you talked about the advertising things that took place, and there was no pickup or a small amount of pickup in the beginning stages of this. And I know that we have a lot, I don't want to call them regulars, but we see people that, you know, who came in last year, they remembered, oh, geez, I got to get in before the end of March and get this thing filled out. Or at a number of events that I met, people are asking, well, yeah, drop in the office, we'll give you the form. Do we don't send that out, and just correct me, I know some programs, if you've taken them up before, you'll get a notice that they're available again. Do we send out to all of those, I see one of the young ladies saying yes there, and you can confirm this on the record then, so we send notice if John Doe applied last year and got the heating rebate in some format, he gets notice this year that is again available to him, possibly?
I'll let
Rio respond.
Ms. Sure. Perkins?
We do send each recipient of the program in 1 year the blank application, which is completed with their name and address at the beginning of the next program year. So they just need to indicate their household size and heating type and sign the form, and they're ready to go. And that's with a self-addressed envelope, a postage paid as well.
And that goes to every single one of those people?
Every single person, okay, who received it.
And maybe some of those get lost along the way. And the reason I ask this, I have had others come in when I say repeat customers, they'll come in and say, hey, I didn't get my whatever this year, and it doesn't matter to us. You know, we've got copies of the forms, we do it, we mail them, we do whatever's required, because it is a program that does get quite a bit of uptake. And when you talk about 50,000 applicants, that's a lot. I'm surprised it's not three times that or more, in all honesty, when I think about the number of households in the province, the number of families that I deal with just alone in my constituency, and in talking to others in other constituencies. So times are very tough. Thousands of jobs have been lost in this province, and specifically in the Valley, and my area of Hants West is no exception. Severance packages, you know, gypsum company was an example. Then they're on EI. That runs out, and you're talking about guys that have worked there their whole life. They're now 50, 55 years old, and what are they doing? Unfortunately, the times get even harder. And so you see this, I can see the growth in this program and more uptake, and that's why I'm a bit surprised that we didn't see maybe the estimated 70,000 and beyond take part in this program. So I hope that we continue to get that word out. I know that my office does everything we can to promote that program, because we know unfortunately, and I say that strongly, unfortunately, that there is a need for this program. And the more money that can be invested in it, especially with the rising cost of energy, and we've heard others talk about that, whether it be electricity, oil, et cetera, we know they're not going down. We see again recently the high cost of energy is going to take yet another jump in all likelihood, unfortunately, unless somebody steps in and says no. And of course, we'll fight that as we need to, but in the end of the day, we may have no ability to control that. So this program remains vitally important, and there are no room, unfortunately, for decreases in it right now. At some point, hopefully, there will be. It would be great somewhere down the road if this program wasn't even needed, but I can't see that given where we are. I'll get on to a couple other questions here. I have a couple of constituents, and I think, Mr. McNeil, you might have gave a number of the number that were refused or turned back over the number that applied. Mm-hmm. 50-odd thousand applied, and how many were turned back out of that?
Mr. McNeil?
And maybe just in the essence of time, I'll carry on with my question as you look for that. I know you quoted it there at one point. But
coming from all directions.
Okay, go ahead.
I don't think that one's as up to date as declined, total declined to date, 3,092.
So 3,000 plus were declined, and that is based on, can you just give me a couple of examples why they would be declined?
I would say mainly due to not meeting the threshold requirement, so okay, that would be over income. And not being able to provide proof of purchase or the energy source.
Okay.
Would be one. Would they be the top?
Good. I was hoping you'd mention that because I want to go there for just a minute. I'll take the first one on, and it's about threshold. And it's interesting when we look at estimated 70,000, and I can appreciate that process, budgeting and so on. There's a number that you were working with. You wanted to stay within, obviously, because of the capability that you had. 50,000 took part in this, so there's a big window there, and I know that Mr. Younger had broached this as well, and you gave some explanations. There was still an ability to put out a bit more money if necessary. So it's about the threshold. Obviously, the threshold, you got to pick a number somewhere, I suppose, when you look at this, but if you didn't have the full uptake, what difference does the threshold really make? If the threshold were higher, would that not open the door to more people applying and reaching that 70,000? What I'm finding, and I hear from a whole variety of different age groups and income level people, working families, non-working families, two people working families, you can appreciate the whole demographic. The people, generally speaking, that are making more money, are spending more money, have bigger homes, have two cars maybe instead of one, or one instead of none, so they're actually spending more money. They would say to you right now, you should up that threshold and allow us to be part of that because we are spending an incredible amount of money investing it back in the province through economic measures and so on and buying fuel and buying electricity and all of that. So I don't know whether that's something that will be considered into the future or not, but if you're not getting the full uptake at the lower income levels that you've set, some consideration should be given to that. And maybe it has, I don't know, and I'll give you a minute to speak to that. I know we don't have a lot of time, but I'll offer you an opportunity to speak to that.
So the program thresholds are based on LICO, the low-income cutoff, as published by Stats Canada, and so that's kind of the basis of the program. And yes, we have modeled, what would happen if we, increased by certain increments over the low-income cutoff, and from time to time, and it gets very pricey, very quickly.
No question.
Because once you start to do that, your population growth within those income brackets expands quite rapidly. So, yes, we have modeled it, we have looked at it, we have costed it out.
Thank you. I want to go back to the other one you mentioned, and that was about the proof of a purchase of your fuel source or whatever it might be. That I had a constituent come into my office. He completed this application, and he was living in a residence where he qualified without any problem. He purchased the oil. Because he has no ability to have a credit card based on his almost zero income, I mean, you can just appreciate where he's at, he pays cash for his oil. So he gives his oil money to the landlord, who was there the day the oil was delivered, a couple hundred, $300, $400, whatever it was. He buys it. He gets a receipt. He even gets a letter from the landlord who said, I paid on behalf of this gentleman the oil bill, sends it all in, and he's refused because he's no longer living at that residence. But he still purchased the fuel oil for that residence. Why would he not qualify? The purchase was still made.
Mr. Malloy.
Would you like Rhea to respond to this, please?
Ms. Perkins.
Thank you. The aim of the program is to provide assistance for people in the heating year in which they apply. So while we do accept bills from the January previous to when we open the program so that people can apply early in the heating season before they might have purchased fuel, we do need the address of the fuel bill to match the residence that the person is living at. So he would have been eligible the previous year for fuel purchase at his previous address. If people move very close to the start of the heating season, we might consider that, but where people move early in the year, we're not able to do that.
This actually wasn't that far apart. It was a fall date, and then he applied, of course, into the new year. I guess what it really comes back to, the goal of the program is to help people who are low income or within a threshold, who are having a hard time making ends meet, who need a little assistance in purchasing. Mm-hmm. And again, it's a good program. And I can see where, you know, there's some risk in what you're saying. I don't take that away at all. Anybody could get a receipt and say, oh, yeah, I live there. I mean, I'm sure we run into a whole variety of problems. I guess what I found troublesome with this is he actually had the receipt from the purchase of the oil. He had a letter from the landlord who actually paid it and said, yes, this gentleman lived at this residence from this time to this time. He did actually pay for and purchase the oil. We sent that back, and there were questions when it came back, and we helped him out, and we sent it back in. And again, he still refused. But he raises a very good point. Yes, I still purchased the fuel. The money still came out of my pocket, and I still burnt the fuel, right? I don't live there now. If you're going to have a program that allows you to file from one date to the next date, I guess I struggle, as does he greatly, much more than me probably, to understand. Seems pretty simple. Why isn't that working? And we need to look at, I think, strongly how we're doing that. And maybe there's another verifier, you know, another qualifier mechanism you need to make that work. I don't know, but I'm interested in what your thoughts are on that.
Mr. Malloy.
Thank you. At Service Nova Scotia, we deliver a ton of programs.
Yes,
like
you
this.
Do.
And unfortunately, regardless of how much thought and effort goes into building the parameters around any program, you're always going to run into difficult circumstances. What I will do for you today is I will follow up with you on getting the particulars on this situation, and we'll re-examine it and get back to you with our answer rather than taking up time here today. I just want you to appreciate the fact that when you have programs, when you get 50, 60,000 applications, if we don't give staff sufficient parameters upon which to make decisions, then you get unequal treatment to citizens, and that is not something that's great either. So,
no, and I can appreciate that, and I know that there are a wide variety of programs that are, and I know that, you know, God only knows how many one individual go through to have to look at and process and so on, and I'm okay with all of that, don't get me wrong. I appreciate that. I guess there will always be circumstances whereby it's not an everyday run-of-the-mill application, yet approves, thanks, checks in the mail. You know, there were 50,000 of them, and there were 3,000 and some odd others. So the focus obviously is we're looking at these 3,000. I hope we look at these 3,000 a little differently. Oh, okay, not just a simple everyday application. That goes here for a bit. We're gonna come back to that and we're gonna say, okay, why doesn't this work? Yeah. Maybe this is a good application, but something is missing. So it's sent back, right? You send it back and say, okay, it's missing A, B, or C, or whatever it might be in what is quite a simple application, by the way, which makes it good for people. It's just straight up, it's two or three things, bang, you sign it, and off you go, and that's good. That's the way they all should be, in all honesty, as far as I'm concerned, because people will be deterred when they look at these lengthy applications for things. It's stressful for them, and they don't know what to do with them. We spend a lot of time in my office offering assistance to filling these things out, even though they are straightforward. We try as many as we can, and I tell people, bring it in. We'll send it in for you if need be, because we want to look at it to make sure that a lot of these simple things are completed, that they haven't missed anything. But we'll still miss them too on occasion, probably. But there's this piece that's very, very important to this gentleman, of course. Maybe I'll forward that to you a little later as we talked about. Look, that would be great if we could have another look at it. And if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. But I think that there's a lot of value in this particular case, as with this resident, knowing his financial status. And knowing that, again, he'll apply next year, and if he's living at the same residence, I'm certain that he'll qualify, as he probably has in years past. But at the same time, it is worth mentioning, I think. The other one, how much time do I have, Mr. Chair? I know we're just probably...
1 minute.
But 1 minute. I just wanted to mention the one on wood. I didn't realize that piece about the affidavit. For some reason, I missed that somewhere along the line. And like I said, we hand a lot of these out. People come in, if they, and we tell them, oh, you don't have a receipt for the wood. Obviously, you can't submit, and you need it. A lot of times folks will pay cash for their wood and maybe get a better buy on that than they would if they were getting the rebate included, because wood is indeed expensive right now too. So just for my own clarity on that again, if a woodlot owner is cutting his own wood, there's an affidavit that he can sign or she can sign and send in for a claim.
Mr. Malloy?
I'm getting a yes from the young lady there.
Yes, on the record.
Yes, on the record.
I'd like to... respond in a different way, though. The fact that I've had two or three members across say to me that I'm not aware of that is a problem to me. So I'm just asking staff over here, are we advertising this? How are we making people aware of this? So the simple fact that it's not known about to me is something, to your earlier point, about
unfortunately,
the
you keep order, please. Mr. Porter's time has expired, but I'm going to address that issue at the end of the meeting. Thank you very much. Mr. Ramey.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I have to say, it would be hard on somebody's head who was numerically challenged to listen to this morning. I mean, I don't know how many numbers have been pounded around in here, but quite a few. And I'd like to just say very quickly, you know, part of the reason I got into politics, which I sometimes, you know, ruminate on, was to try to do something for people who most need our help. And you know, one group of people who most need our help are the people we're talking about this morning. And I'm not very interested in any kind of partisan discussion about it at all. I could care less, quite frankly, about that. The people I'm concerned about are the people who are eligible for this program and who get served by it. And I'd like to commend you for trying to come up with the best possible way of doing that, because it's a very complicated thing. And I know one of the members over there suggested, you know, when you change something even by a couple of dollars and you multiply it by a big number of people, it comes out to a very large number of dollars. So I don't envy you the work that you've done, and I think you've thought long and hard about this, and I think you've come up with a good plan, and it helps an awful lot of people. And I, for one, am very pleased to live in a province where we care about folks. So, but my question goes really, you know, forgetting all this stuff about numbers and everything, goes back to the people who were served by the program. And you mentioned, I think at the very beginning, or very close to the beginning, a survey that had been conducted among the people who I care about the most, who are the people that are served by the program. And so, I would like you to, if you don't mind, to just say a few things about the types of questions that were on it, and again, what the people said, because as I indicated at the very beginning, these are the people I care about. They are the people that we should be paying attention to.
Mr. Malloy?
I'd like Rhea to take this, please.
Ms. Perkins?
Yes, we ran this program about this time last year. We had two of our contact center staff who alternated between taking calls on the program and making these outgoing calls on the survey. As Cameron and the deputy have mentioned, satisfaction from the survey was very high. 92% said that they were either satisfied or very satisfied from the program. We called a total of 400 applicants. Half of those were people who had applied in that program year, and half of those were people who had applied the previous year but not reapplied. Mm-hmm. Some other of the key findings were that 94% indicated that they had found the application form clear and easy to fill out. 97% said that the application process was simple. People were very anxious to see the program continue. Most of the people, as we've said, found out about the program through either newspapers, which was about 30%, and a combined 43% through word of mouth. So either directly word of mouth was their response, or through a community organization or a family member. Only two respondents reported finding out about the program through their MLA, though we've heard from lots of MLAs that they're telling people, so they must just be forgetful. More than half of the people who did not reapply, it was because they had changed or improved their circumstances. So many of those people had, more than half of the applicants from 2 years prior had more income, 42% more income, and another 13% who had moved and didn't pay heed anymore. We also heard that 21% had missed the deadline and may have benefited from a reminder halfway through the program, which is part of the reason we chose to do a second round of advertising this year. 105 of the 157 respondents who applied in the program year that we had just finished indicated that they had received their pre-populated application, so we find that's working as well. Very few of our applicants were renters. Because we heard so much about community organizations as a useful method of accessing the program, we did a review of organizations across the province and had a staff member actually contact these organizations by telephone and solicit their help in distributing application forms. In terms of comments from the program, there were several along similar lines. One person said that they were very happy, please continue the program, it's a good help. Just keep it going, it's a big help, mm-hmm. Hope it's back next winter. Wonderful program, thank you. A lot of comments along those lines.
Well, okay, so for me, that's the most valuable piece of information I gleaned from this morning. You had a lot of stuff there, and it was all good, and it was all very high percentages. You mentioned there were a group of people who hadn't applied who were, I think you said, because their circumstances had changed in a, for the most part in a favorable way. What percentage of people was that?
43%.
43% had improved?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. So that's absolutely terrific. The second question I have, which is really a quick snapper here, is I did see on TV home heating rebate ad. I don't know how long ago. It was back, you know, in the middle of the program, probably. I'm surprised that TV is not one of the best ways. Am I gathering that correctly to get the word out? I know you said newspaper and word of mouth. Is TV not that successful?
This was the first year we'd used television advertising, so we didn't have any statistics for that for the survey year.
So you'll know by next year.
So we'll know next year.
Okay. I don't want to take up any more time. I know my colleague, Mr. McKinnon, wants to ask a couple more questions. Thank you very much.
Mr. McKinnon.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to take a little bit of issue with Mr. Younger's line of questioning this morning, because I think I'm not going to say that he was confused, though he was in a couple of areas. But the points that he was trying to make was, I believe, that he was trying to take a very fluid program that has, in fact, existed for, in one form or another, for almost 10 years under three different names. And this very fluid program, with so many changes in it, with so many variables over those years, and it seemed that the line of questioning was trying to take a fluid program and turn it into something that was static or fixed or picking some time frames of comparison and so on. And there were so many changes in the increases in availability and the amount of outreach and the changes in the amounts, starting with $50 and the changes that took place in relationship to that. And even the Salvation Army program, which at one time was in fact 5 years, and it was 3 years, and it was 2 years, the confusion that surrounded that. And correct me if I'm wrong, but the Salvation Army allocation actually changed at one point as well. And what we have is, I believe, that Salvation Army Good Neighbor Fund is a great expenditure. I am so proud of your department putting $400,000 shots into that program, because from my constituency office, and I can extrapolate that to other constituency offices throughout the province, that program is different. It's fundamentally different from the heating rebate program, the heating assistant rebate program, because the Good Neighbor program is an emergency. It's a last-ditch effort. It reaches out to people that are really in distress. And what we're dealing with the HART program is, we're going a spectrum from low to moderate income, and I don't think that was being factored in. But can you just tell us the changes, probably based on the fact that there is departmental support, but the changes in the allocation that the Salvation Army comes up with, if you would.
Mr. McNeil.
When we first approached the Salvation Army with an offer of support to their program in 2008, their program at that time consisted largely of donations provided from the employees of Nova Scotia Power Corporation through a donation setup, and matched by the power company, and some fuel credits that were provided by heating oil providers in the province. It was very restricted in its ability to help impoverished Nova Scotians, and it did at that time have a 5-year cycle, meaning that if you were a recipient of a grant from that program, that you couldn't reapply until 5 years had fully elapsed. We provided Salvation Army. First of all, the program was very attractive to us on a couple of fronts. It had a province-wide reach. It was integrated at the grassroots level with community groups, churches, and so forth, right across the province. It was had a very lean administrative component to it, but a very effective administrative component to it. They had established clear criteria as to who was eligible, and also had established clear communication networks with energy providers. So basically, when someone was in distress, in an emergency situation, a single mom with small children, out of heat in the middle of the winter, it could be called into action immediately. A phone call was made to a heating oil provider, and that the furnace, that host was warm within a very short period of time. And that was very appealing to us because, as Mr. McKinnon, as you pointed out, that's not the way our program worked. So we provided the $400,000. And I believe that might have even been increased for that 1 year, or the following year. And we were very clear that we did not want in any way to interfere with the Salvation Army's protocols or program. We piloted that for a year. They ran it, and it was most effective. The feedback on it was very positive. Their administration is incredible, that they're incredibly efficient, and comes at a bargain rate. I think overall their program has maybe $27,000 associated with all administrative costs. So I believe that to be the case. Over the years, as we became more committed with budget for the Salvation Army, the program grew in both volume and outreach, and also further networked with other community-based groups, and really, you know, proved to be a very effective outreach program. It also integrated more with our Department of Community Services, so the communication channels were improved on that basis. And to your point, it really is gives a quick response in emergency situations. And frankly, as administrators supporting the program, we're delighted with the way it's working.
And the amount also increased as well, right, over the years. I remember it was a much lesser amount years ago, right, the actual amount of individual assistance.
I believe at one time we provided $800,000 to the program early on, and then from there it was $400,000 each year afterwards, and then this year it went to $800,000.
Sorry, for the individual receiving the emergency funding, the amount increased over the years.
I don't have that information readily at hand. I can tell you that it has varied in the amount that they provide. I've heard as low as $200.
That's what it was when I was first involved with it.
Right, and I believe I heard as high as $400, and it's currently around $350 is what the maximum is. But I think there can be gradients in between, depending on the circumstance. They're very flexible that way.
It was the increase that I was drawing out there, because I remember when it was 200, and I was going to share time with Mr. Smith, but I have to apologize to him because I don't think there's anything left to share. Sorry.
Thank you very much. Just before we conclude, you did mention, I wanted to address this again, the sworn affidavit for someone cuts their own wood. Would you make that available to all committee members, how that process works and how that would be done? There was some, Mr. McKenna just asked about the breakdown of the Salvation Army, what the grant was originally, and what it evolved into or from. And it was also some discussion about the $500 increments where above the threshold, was that actually put in place? And if it was, could we get a written description on that as well, how that works? And with that, we only have very few minutes left. I'd ask the Deputy Minister, is any final short comments you would like to make? Oh, yes, the wood, Mr. Younger.
Sorry, a number of people, I think the Deputy Minister pointed out the how you apply if you cut your own wood.
That was the affidavit I was talking
about. Oh, that was the affidavit, yes. Sorry.
Mr. Porter.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I know we're pressed for time, and maybe instead of getting it just to committee members, I wonder if, Deputy, if you could send that to the members' offices, constituency offices, given that most of us are probably dealing with the issue. I would just as soon get it there, and then I would have a copy of that as opposed to going through the process of committee and then having to disperse it out to others anyway. Would there be some value in that, maybe, Mr. Chair, having it go to all offices?
Yes, if that'd be possible. We also have to send it to committee, though, to keep us all legal.
So thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you all. I just want to reference very quickly that our young technology people have given me our website, and there is actually a section on there that says, I heat with wood, do I qualify for rebate? And it says, if you do not have a receipt or if you cut your own wood, please see below for a copy of our invoice sheet and statutory declaration. So both those documents are available on our website. But due to the confusion, I will commit to send it out, an information circular or out to all MLA offices with clarity on this so that we can benefit all Nova Scotians. Just two further points, Mr. Chair. First of all, I'd like to thank staff. We don't often get the opportunity to thank the people who spend many hours in the Maritime Center processing applications on behalf of these people to move the money and get the rebates through as quickly as we can. So I'd like to like to thank everyone. Finally, the Your Energy Rebate Program, and this was to an earlier point that was raised, was initially an application-based program. And we looked at that and we said there's no way that a lot of people are ever going to get the benefit that they're entitled to if we make it an application-based program. And we worked very well with the oil industry and with Nova Scotia Power to find other ways. And what we ended up doing was coming up with a direct credit on their bills, whether it be delivery of oil or the electricity. And so at Service Nova Scotia, we currently constantly strive to build a process that allows our rebate programs to be benefit as many people as we possibly can. And we will continue to look at this program to see if there's any other alternatives that we can put into place to ensure that every single Nova Scotian that is eligible for this program receives this rebate. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to, again, thank your staff for the great work they are doing in this regard. And I know many of my constituents, as I believe all our constituents, have benefited from this. So, again, thank you for the fine job you're doing. Just a couple of things. There was some information out to sent to all caucuses, a Better Care Sooner information that was sent out on April 4th. Hopefully all caucuses have received that. Our next meeting is May the 23rd. It's the Capital District Health overtime costs for nursing staff at Capital Health. And unless the members have anything else, a motion to adjourn be in order. It's been moved by Mr. McKinnon. We stand adjourned.